Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Christ Lutheran Church and welcome to Ash Wednesday worship. Glad to have you all here as we officially begin Lent. I know we've got a couple people who haven't been with us or some visiting. If you remember, it's easier if you take the liturgy away from all the inserts. That way you can follow us along a lot easier. In the bulletin today, just a couple of real quick announcements. Remember, we are celebrating Bev Blake's life this Friday, busy week, at 11 o'clock, if you'd like to attend. Bev died recently, and we will lift her up. Interesting to have that on the Friday after Ash Wednesday, where we remember that we are dust, and to dust we shall return, but it has no dominion over us because of the victory. Some of you are asking, why do you already have a cross? Because we're using makeup applicators, and I don't have a mirror up at the altar. It's about the cross and Jesus, not me. Prayers for the world, you will see that in here. We started it last Sunday. Remember, keep Ukraine in your prayers. If you have friends and neighbors or wondering how they can help, you may want to share that prayer with them for the world, which reaches out specifically to Ukraine and all the issues going on, not just there, but around the world. I also saw that Diane English is wearing a Ukrainian flag sticker that you got that in a square somewhere in villages. So that's outward support for the people of Ukraine. So keep those things up. And definitely talk about those things from a faith perspective. The Lord's watching. The Lord is intervening in ways we see and we cannot see. That was my devotional for the day. When I read it today, I thought, wow, how perfect. It said, my ways are wiser than yours, and I know more than you do. So sometimes just pray, shut up, and let me do my job. That's kind of my version of the devotion, not exactly what it was. We are having a meal. If you'd like to stay, please do. Thank you for everyone who made soup. It smells really good in the fellowship hall. My thanks to Sharon and Patty, and I saw Sandy helping out. Kay Bertzik's not here today. Her brother had a stroke. He's coming home today. He's doing okay, but then when he went in the hospital, he tested positive for COVID. So if you can help us, Kay was going to be in charge of this today and Friday's celebration of life. And soup sales for Lent. So when a valuable leader like that goes, guess what? All of you got to fill in. Kay's got big shoes, not real big feet, but big shoes, right? So if you can help, let Sharon, you all know Sharon. Sharon, raise your hand. And Patty, where's Patty? She's in. There's Patty. And of course, Sandy's helping out today. So give them all an amen. Thank you for rallying around. So Kay does not have any symptoms, by the way, but she's quarantining. We're going to take a quiet minute now to prepare our hearts and minds. For worship. Yes?
Today is the first Ash Wednesday in the sanctuary.
Yes, it is. Maybe that was coming up in preaching. Maybe not now. Give Bill a big amen. As you're able for our gathering hymn, Bob will have it up there. If you like the hymnal 324, it will be up here on the monitors.
Mm-hmm.
seated. We continue with worship on page 2 of your worship folder with the apostolic greeting. The grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. We come together in confession. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God our Father and of one another. Most holy and merciful God our Father, we confess to you and to one another, and before your whole company of heaven, that we sin by our own fault, by our own most grievous fault, in action, thought, word, and deed, by what we do and by what we leave undone. At times we do not love you with our whole heart, mind, soul, and strength. At times we do not love our neighbors as ourselves. At times we do not forgive others as we are forgiven. At times we shut our ears to your call to serve your Son Jesus and his ministries and missions as he serves us. At times we reject Jesus' will for our lives. At times we grieve you, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit for our unfaithfulness, pride, envy, hypocrisy, and apathy that infect our lives. We confess you for our self-indulgent appetites and ways and our exploitation of your creation and people. We confess to you for our negligence in prayer, worship, and service, and our failure to share the faith that is in us. We confess to you for our neglect of human need and suffering, and our indifference to injustice and cruelty. We confess to you for our false judgments, our uncharitable thoughts towards our neighbors, and our prejudice and contempt toward your people who differ from us. We confess to you for our waste and pollution of your creation and our lack of concern for your people who come after us. We confess to you. Restore us, O God our Father, and let your anger depart from us. Forgive us, O God our Father, for your mercy in your Son Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, is great. Amen. We continue with the prayer of the day, beginning there on page 2, continuing on page 3. Let us pray it together. Almighty and eternal God our Father, you hate nothing you made or continue to make. And for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, you forgive the sins of all of your people who are penitent. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, continue to create in us new, clean, and honest hearts, minds, and souls, so that truly repenting of our sins, we receive from you, God our Father of all mercy, full pardon and forgiveness through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We continue with our prayer for the world, praying it together. Let us pray. Let us pray for all victims of any forms of violence, terror, human trafficking, and all displaced peoples, all victims of ethnic, racial, gender, sexual, political, and religious discrimination and violence, all victims of natural disasters or human-made disasters, all victims of war or warlike activity, conflict, oppression, and strife, including in Afghanistan, Syria, Ukraine, and Yemen. Gracious God, our Father of healing and wholeness, through the power of the Holy Spirit, bring relief in every way you see fit for those impacted by natural disasters, human-made disasters, conflicts, persecutions, and wars. Empower all peoples to reach out to those impacted through the healing power of Jesus Christ. God, our Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we admit our human frailties and recognize we live in a fallen creation. Restore us each and every way as you see fit, so that your will is done. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. At this time, we're going to have the imposition of ashes here at the altar rail. You will come up the same as you do for Holy Communion. I want to show you what we're going to do. This happened last year, for the most part, through car windows. Aren't you glad we don't have to do that anymore? But the pandemic has brought good things about as well. Because we didn't know about touch last year, which we thought possibly was spreading the contagion, we developed this, which Michelle found. This is a makeup applicator of some sort. I'm a dude. I don't know anything about this. But it works really well, doesn't it? But I had one of these for each one of you last year, if it was a couple you shared. So we had a lot of these that went away. We're only going to have to use one or two of them today. To that I say amen and hallelujah. Because you know how I am about Mother Earth. On the eighth day, God did not create landfills for this stuff, right? So if you want to come up, just come up for ashes. You can come up down the center as you normally would, again, for communion. Bob, if you want to come up first, and then you can just play some background music. And after we're done, you'll see the insert with the liturgy. That's the ghost of Bob Cetera, the track lights that are never on. See, Bob, where are you at, Bob? All right, Bob, see, now you can harass them the rest of your life. This is one of my favorite days because, remember, I get to look out at all of you and I see the mark of Christ on all of you, which is always there, but it's oftentimes invisible. Not today. And now you can brag about how good the crosses are when people go, "How did your pastor do that?" Makeup applicator. Works well, doesn't it? And that's part of the pandemic. So remember things like that. God was working good even in the middle of the pandemic, that we never would have thought of that. And we looked and looked, and Michelle found that somewhere on the internet. Amazon? How many of those did you have to buy? 500. Remember, because we didn't know about sharing back then. So if you're a couple of you, so we have plenty of them to go for plenty of Ash Wednesdays in the future, right, Lou? The liturgy is in your bulletin for the conclusion of the application. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, accomplish in us, O God our Father, the work of your Son, Jesus, divine salvation, that we show forth his glory in all of your world. By the cross and passion of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, bring us all, with all of your saints, to the joy of Jesus' resurrection. Almighty God, our Father, have mercy on us. Forgive us all our sins through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, continue to strengthen us in your holiness and keep us in Jesus, eternal life.
Amen. Amen.
Our gospel hymn is next. I'll have it up there on the board if you'd like to follow along the hymnal, 325. As you're able for the reading of the gospel. If you had a chance to read my newsletter article, I added some stanzas to that hymn. We may have to try them some Sunday. What do you think, Mr. Dunbar? Everybody say good morning, Diane. She has our gospel for Ash Wednesday.
Good morning, Diane.
In this part of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, Jesus commends almsgiving, prayer, and fasting, but emphasizes the spiritual devotion must not be for show. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus taught his disciples and those gathered, beware of practicing your piety before others in order to be seen by them, for then you have no reward from your Father in heaven. So whenever you give alms, do not sound a trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, so that they may be praised by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your alms may be done in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door, and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you fast, do not look dismal like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces so as to show others that they are fasting. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that your fasting may be seen not by others, but by your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust consumes, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May be seated. Give Diana, big amen. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, as we gather on this Lenten season beginning today with Ash Wednesday, with millions if not billions of Christians around the world, those able to celebrate, those having tasks to be done today, they are celebrating with us in spirit. This cross that is on our forehead is a cross that reminds us that we are created by you in your image out of the dust of the earth, which we will return to. We also know that you will raise us up into a new body, all because of the righteousness of your Son. We don't do the cross for show. We do it as honor for what your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, has first done for us in his life, death, resurrection, ascension, and his glorious promise to return. May we live it out as best as we are as we celebrate this Lenten season, looking forward to Holy Week as well as Easter Sunday morning and the season of Easter, and move us forward in faith as crucified and risen people in the name of the Lord, always serving him and always ignited with the Holy Spirit and fire. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. Great to be with you here this morning. A little housekeeping. I just looked down and I'm like, either I'm crooked or that's crooked. Today we celebrate Ash Wednesday in the beginning of Lent, and amen and hallelujah. And as Bill said, amen and hallelujah, as this is the first one in here. We will also have our first Holy Week in here this year, and we will have our first Easter Sunday in Jesus' new sanctuary. How about that? Amen. Amen and hallelujah. A lot of Lenten discipline went into making this place happen, and that is a good thing because you can see the fruits of the Spirit. Are you excited about those things? Okay, at least Bill is back there. That's good.
We are.
Jesus strong. In the good news of Lent that we begin today, I like to name seasons. You may not. I mean, we call it Lent, but to me, this is really theologically the season of Jesus' cross, where we really focus in the lessons and the things about what he's doing, processing to his cross, which, of course, for him was agonizing and brutal, but he did it out of his free will on behalf of his Father and the Holy Spirit and himself so that we would have salvation. And there's a huge connection to the biblical Hebrew scriptures that we're going to cover a little bit today. The season of Easter always reminds me of the season of the empty tomb, the tomb that could not hold our Lord and Savior. You've heard me say this many times, but the gospel writes, the stone was rolled away. Oh, my heavens. No, it wasn't. It was blasted open. They couldn't contain Jesus in death. The devil tried to hold him in hell itself. And the stone is blasted. And then he comes out and says, I told you so. My cross is victory. This tomb is victory. Because death has no dominion over you or me. That's what this cross means today. Maybe on Easter we should have, do you think I could probably use that little and make a tomb with a stone? No? Would take a lot more ashes to make a solid stone. Alan's saying, what are you talking about? You know I'm crazy, Alan. I don't think there'd be a lot in attendance that day. What do you think? In this incredible good news, this is one of the days in the church that the church, in my opinion, the lectionary, really gets right. But it's also unique. Think about as you run through your head, the days in the church calendar year, they can fall at a different time, as Lent and Easter always do, but always have the exact same gospel lesson. This is one of a few. We always have this lesson from St. Matthew. Start jogging your mind. Reformation Sunday, we always have St. John chapter 8. But if you believe in the Son, what? Sets you free. And we always have St. Luke's Gospel on Christmas Eve. You know the one, chapter 2, the birth narrative of Jesus. Are you starting to flow with me theologically? Isn't that fun to think along these lines? Did any of you really remember that this is one of those days? It's one of the few ones that we ever have St. Matthew as the Gospel. I mean, you can look at the second Sunday of Easter every year. The second Sunday is back to St. John's Gospel, chapter 20. And you remember The disciples that were still there, minus Thomas, were what? In a room locked in fear of the Jews, right? And you know the story. Jesus appears and then later appears to Thomas. So you're starting to catch on to where I'm going here about why this is important that the church locks this in. But you should also chuckle at the church. Did you hear what Diane wrote or read at the beginning? Beware of practicing your piety so that you may be seen by others. Hello, we're all wearing a cross of ash on our foreheads. Have you noticed that? Have you looked around? You may not see yourself. Can't you laugh with the church sometimes? We focus on some serious things today. When Jesus gives us those words, he's giving them to us from the Sermon on the Mount. It is three chapters long. All of chapter 5, we have the beginning of chapter 6 and chapter 7, if you would like to read it. It is his entire sermon, the longest version we have of it. It's only recorded as a Sermon on the Plain in St. Luke's Gospel, but it is a very abbreviated version of this. But you should also be asking yourself something every year, because I put it into the lessons before. It always mind is boggling to me when Scripture is removed. You probably noticed, I hope, that there are Scriptures not in the text today. Did you notice those? 7 through 15 isn't there. Do you remember what it is? Nobody knows? Y'all, man, I'm going to have to start a lot more Bible studies. It's one of the most important teachings Jesus ever gave us, the Lord's Prayer. Isn't it odd that it's not there when he's talking about be diligent in prayer and pray to your Father who sees what you do in silence? How many of you pray the Lord's Prayer frequently? I pray it every day. We do it every Sunday. You can fib and say, well, okay, Pastor, I should. It's only recorded in two of our Gospels. It's in St. Matthew and it's in St. Luke chapter 11. It's slightly different. But think about this in relation to what we are doing today with our giving, which is almsgiving, our prayer, and our fasting, which fasting to me is really more about how we're focusing on what's on our forehead, which leads us into ministry and missions, such as food for St. Teresa's. Jesus goes on when the message that we're missing here today, the verses in chapter 6, verse 7, he starts continuing on in prayer and how important it is for us in today's gospel. In your prayers, do not use a lot of meaningless words as the pagans do, who think that God will hear them because of their long prayers. I had a person one time who told me, I just am not good at praying, and I try. And I said, prayer's just dialogue with God. God listens to billions of people. Can you imagine how busy the lines of communication are? Can you imagine how busy the lines of communication are? They're infinite. I said, pray the Lord's Prayer. They had never thought about that before. That's opening a door. Do not be like them, Jesus teaches. Your Father already knows what you need before you ask him. Isn't that beautiful? This then is how you should pray. This radically changed the world. No one was allowed to say these words. Our Father, radically changing the world, the kingdom of heaven given back to us. You were not allowed to say God's name in Hebrew. You did not. You used the words such as Adonai. You skipped over God's name. You didn't say it. Jesus is teaching a bunch of Jewish people, including his inner circle, start out with our Father. That's exciting. Our Father in heaven, may your holy name be honored. May your kingdom come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today the food we need. Forgive us the wrongs that we have done. And forgive the wrongs that others have done us. Do not bring us to hard testing. But keep us safe from, this is the exact translation, the evil one. Don't we all need that? If you forgive others the wrongs that they have done you, your Father in heaven will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive the wrongs of others, then your Father in heaven will not forgive the wrongs you have done. There is a word of warning after he teaches that. And how hard is that? You remember what Peter said. My gosh, how many times do I have to forgive somebody? Seven times? 70 times. Oh, Jesus made it quite infinite, didn't he? We all struggle with that a little bit, don't we? Don't we? This is interactive, I'm telling you. It's just because it's Wednesday. It's incredible good news because Jesus leads us to that and gives us that beautiful prayer. And all he's saying today on this Ash Wednesday all the time is, I've given you your very life, the resources that you have. Give them away as the Holy Spirit helps and guides you collectively and as individuals. Do not hold on to things. Nothing is life is going with you. To dust you shall return, but I claim you in the dust before your birth and into your next life. In prayer, if you find it difficult, pray that prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. God is listening and answering. Your kingdom come, your will be done. Those are good words, aren't they? And in fasting, instead of thinking about what you can't do, which somebody told me a long time ago, I gave up Coke for Lent. You know what I said? Big deal. Do you really think Jesus Christ cares that you gave up Coca-Cola? They got mad at me. But I love Coca-Cola. I said, if you're going to give up Coca-Cola, what are you doing with the money that you used to spend on Coca-Cola? My advice to all of us in fasting as we look within ourselves and repent and reflect is to reach out. To me, fasting is to turn and do things for God. You notice we do that with the Lent food drive. Did you notice we do that every year now? There's a reason. Repentance means look at ourselves and everything we've got, and Jesus says, reach out so that the kingdom comes to all people. This is exciting. Radical teaching in part of the Sermon on the Mount. But where do we get this? Why is today the beginning of Lent? The church gets it right. And church, to me, doesn't always get it right. If the church always got it right, it would be perfect. And of course, it is not. Have you noticed?
Oh, yeah.
If the church got it right, the Lord's Prayer would be in there today. The church does get it right today. I'm not getting it right. I need an engineer. That's better. You like laughing at me, don't you? I like it better when Bill says something. Oh well, I'll fix that later. There are special times we hear that we are dust and we shall return. I showed you this if you were here Sunday in Last Rites. For Steve, who received Last Rites last week and then died on Friday, I want to repeat just these parts of this prayer. Everyone who's dying hears their name and these words. For him, it was Steve, our brother in the faith. We entrust you to God, our Father, who created you. And hear clearly the connection to today. May you return to the one who formed us all out of the dust of the earth. So on the beginning of Lent, we're recognizing that we're finite, but God is infinite. And that's why Jesus says, don't worry about these things. I've already claimed you. That's an exciting way to begin Lent, isn't it? But God's already spoken these words, God our Father, many years ago before we were allowed to pray God our Father. This day is directly connected to the Hebrew Scriptures in chapters 1, 2, and 3 of Genesis. You remember those? Do you remember those? It's a little bit lengthy, but I want to read it for you. We're going to begin on the sixth day of creation. Ladies, I always want you to remember this, these incredible words that happened before the creation story of humankind that most people want to dwell on. This is the beginning of that story, and it starts in chapter 1 of Genesis, verse 26. Then God said, "Let us make humankind in our image according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild animals of the earth, and over every other creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." Listen carefully, chapter 1. So God created humankind in God's image. In the image of God, God created them. Ladies, male and female, He created them. We're equal. Don't ever let anybody tell you we're not. This is straight out of the Hebrew Scriptures. Now, we're going to get into a little more detail of the story. And why do you think that happens? People ask God, well, okay, we understand that, but where all did we really come from? You're holding fast to this. You don't sound very excited. I know this is more like a Bible study at the moment. God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth." God said, "See, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit, you shall have them for food. And to the every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food." And so it was. God saw everything that God made, and indeed it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Everything is good at this point, isn't it? Everything is good, and there's no need to know about that we will return to the dust of the earth. And here's where the plot thickens. Drum roll, please. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude. And on the seventh day, God finished the work that He had done and rested on the seventh day from all the work that He had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that God had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and of the earth, and when they were created, in the day that the Lord God had made the heavens and the earth, when no plant or field was yet on the earth, and no herb of the field had yet sprung up, the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no one to till the ground. But a stream would rise from the earth, and the water the whole face of the ground. The Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground. Are you starting to pick up on the dust? But remember, this is a fulfillment of the original creation, that man and woman are equal. And breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east. And there He put the man whom He formed. Out of the ground the Lord God made a tree to grow that is pleasant to the sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Many people forget that there were two trees in the garden that we were not supposed to fool around with. Those are the two. That was a seminary question, which half of us missed. A river flows out of Eden to water the garden, and from there it divides and becomes four branches. The name of the first is Pishon. It is the one that flows around the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold, and the gold of that land is good. Bdellium and onyx stone are there. The name of the second river is Gihon. It is the one that flows around the whole land of Cush. The name of the third river is Tigris, which flows east of Assyria. And the fourth river is the Euphrates. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may eat freely of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in that day that you eat it, you shall die." Then the Lord God said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner." So out of the ground the Lord God formed every animal of the field and every bird of the air and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all cattle and to the birds of the air and to every animal of the field. But for the man there was not found a helper as his partner. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed it up its place with flesh, and the rib of the Lord God had taken from the man. He made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, "This is the last bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of man this one was taken. Therefore a man leaves his father, and someone calls, and his mother, and clings to his wife, and they become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed." So far, the story's going quite well, isn't it? Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal the Lord God had made. And what did we just cover in the Lord's Prayer? Protect us from who? The evil one. He said to the woman, "Did God say you shall not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "You may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die." But the crafty serpent said to the woman, "You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also, listen closely, because women get blamed, listen closely. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her. He was there. Okay, now you couples have good partnerships. So, Alan, if you're driving 100 miles down the road, doesn't Jay say something like, "Slow down"? Because you have that fast car. Hey, guys, where was Adam at? Why didn't he say something? Hang on a second. God said, "Don't do that." He said, "We'll die." It's the only thing. Woman, come on. Let's go to another tree. Come on, that one over there. Look, it's good. Everything's perfect, right? Right? All right, I'm just trying to get you into the story. And he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were opened. They were opened at the same time. Are you catching this? Are you catching this? This is Genesis. I'm not making this up. This is God's word. And they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. That part just cracks me up. This gets funnier. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at that time of the evening breeze. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of God among the trees of the garden. I guess they stayed away from the tree of life and the tree of knowledge of good and evil because they weren't supposed to be near it. There were other trees. Wonder if they had oak trees like all mine that there are leaves all over my house. This is where God gets funny. God knows everything. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" Don't you think God has a sense of humor? The man said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden. I was afraid." Why was he afraid? Why? Okay. "Because I was naked and I hid myself." God said, "Who told you you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" And here comes human sin at its core. The man said, "The woman whom you gave to me, she gave me the fruit of the tree and I ate." Hey, dude, you were right there and could have said no and could have helped her say no. Come on, man. I want to meet Adam and go, what kind of... Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "Here comes, ladies, you're not getting off the hook. The serpent tricked me and I ate." This could have come out different if they both had said, "We sinned. We did what you told us not to do. Lent, repent, admit it, and God gives us the strength." They both wanted to get out of it instead of admitting it. How silly humankind is it? The Lord God said to the serpent, notice who God goes after first, the evil one. "Because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel." To the woman he said, "I will greatly increase your pangs of childbearing. In pain you shall bring forth children, yet your desire shall be for your husband." Ladies, don't worry about this. This is a translation thing. "And he shall rule over you." Remember, it's a covenant of marriage. Two become what? One. And to the man he said, "Because you have listened to the voice of your wife and embedded in there and have not helped her to say no, and have eaten of the tree about which I commanded you, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth, and you shall eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread until you return to the ground. And listen to these words clearly on Ash Wednesday. For out of it you were taken. You are dust, and to dust you shall return. You heard those words today, didn't you? Did you know God said them first? And God put them in last rites? And why is that the beginning of Lent? Particularly for Ash Wednesday. It's our connection to the Hebrew Scriptures and the creation of humankind. Equal creation. It is the creation of humankind who is in sin, which we admit, which we do, and that we will return to the dust. And yet at the beginning of Lent is the beginning of life, because Jesus said in this cross, the dust has no dominion over you. God could have not only expelled Adam and Eve, he could have annihilated them at that point in time. What did he say? Because you have eaten of it, you shall die. But he protected humankind. And then he sent his son. That's the beginning of Lent. That's the celebration. That the scriptures, all of them, are true from beginning to end. This is the beginning of our journey with Christ to his cross. But dust has no dominion over us. And amen. Hallelujah. Don't sound so excited. How many of you knew that that was in Genesis? A few of you, good. How come the Baptists always know more? No, I don't know if that many people know it. We are going to continue with the Apostles' Creed on page 3 of your worship folder. Rise as you are able. On this Ash Wednesday, living together in faith, trust, and hope, let us confess our faith together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As I get the table ready this morning, take me a minute here. Jesus' final words in our teaching for today from chapter 6, which are remarkable. Do not gather earthly things up where moth and rust consume, but focus on the heavenly things, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. It is truly a day, Ash Wednesday, where we get to tell the whole world on our forehead what our ultimate treasure is. Isn't that a beautiful, beautiful way for the church to celebrate? Amen and hallelujah. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body. It is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, our Lord Jesus took the cup. After giving thanks, he gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out the Holy Spirit, that by this holy communion we may know the unity we share with all your people in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray as we will sing the Lord's Prayer. Come to the banquet, for all is now ready. Thanks be to God. Amen. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ continue to strengthen us and keep us in his grace and the power of the healing Holy Spirit now and forever. Amen. Before the final blessing, I'm going to have a meal prayer for those of us who are going to be eating. Just if you would listen with me this morning. Let us pray. Grace Heavenly Father, thank you for the true treasures of the church that celebrates your Son and holy baptism in this wonderful high holy day where we repeat the words that you said to Adam and Eve. Remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return. But we are claimed in that dust before our conception, in our birth, in our life, in our death, and in our journey into eternal life. We receive that here at this holy table, concretely in your Son's precious body and blood, in the simple elements of bread and wine. May we go forward from this place as we are nourished with the food and the soups that are prepared for us and move us forward in faith. We are a church in service and action, so we can bring the good news of salvation to your people. It is very hard at times for people to understand that you care about them, Father God, when they're hungry and tired, or homebound, or they're living on the streets. But we're taking care of those ministries and missions as a small part of your Son's church. And may the Holy Spirit continue to fire us up and ignite us to do so. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. Rise, you're able for the blessing up there. See, it has the "We are Jesus strong in it" peace as well. We pray together. Let us pray. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The Lord is worthy to be praised and adored. So we lift up holy hands in one accord, singing, "Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. We are Jesus strong. Amen." Well, I'll have our hymn up there in a second. Christ, the life of all the living. Amen to that. 339, if you like the hymnal. To bring Christ, our true treasure, to all people today and every day as we fast and give alms and pray and blessed have the Lord's Prayer. Bring Christ to all people today and every day. Go in peace. Enjoy the soup if you're staying and continue to give thanks to God in all things. We will. Thanks be to God. Amen.